Harmonic inputs to the system, we expect the behavior to be harmonic as well, which is why we are doing frequency response here. My aim is to relate the supply voltage to the output voltage taken across the terminals of the inductor. So from that perspective, instead of IMS, I'm going to replace it by VL divided by LS. Relationship. x by 1 because this is a special case. I have a 0 at the origin. I cannot write it in this particular form, so I just leave it like that with a double of aspects. Then I write the denominator in the following form. It is s divided by, I take the L and then bring it down below the resistor R. If I have a non-zero 4 or if I have a non-zero 0, right? In this case, I have a non-zero 4, right? I will be writing it in this particular form which resembles what happened to me. If I have a 0, then it's going to be S divided by that particular one value, a 0 at the origin, or if I have a 4 at the origin. Okay, it can just be S divided by 1. Just to make life simple, that's all. Take all these values, plug it in there. Ts. It's now going to be L by R, which is 1 by L. S by 1. Nothing special. S by R by L, which is 10 by 1. Is my voice audible to all of you? People in the back? Okay, let me know. Okay. Now we write the frequency response function because I really want to draw the body plots, the magnitude and the phase plots. I write the frequency response function. So T of J omega. If you have to take the log to the base 10 of these features, I have the following going on for me in this problem. I have a constant in the numerator. I have a 0 at the origin. System is stable because I get the core value to be minus 10, so I'm good to go. Alright, now I have to do the magnitude plots for M, capital M. And the corner frequency. Corner frequency is useful in the sense of an electrical circuit, but we, as mechanical engineers, our aim is to look at second order circuits. some of the real and imaginary pot squares. I don't have a real part in the numerator, so this is just a big square. This is omega squared, which is omega. I just write it as omega by 1. Given by the denominator has both the real and imaginary part, so the square root of the sum of the squares of those parts. The square root. So log of 20, log of 1 by 10. Of these terms. terminals and these particular values, but from the point of view of an asymptotic analysis. Okay? The first term is an easy one because it is not a function of omega. So wherever I'm sitting, I'm going to be at minus 20 decibels. That first term does not change its nature at all, which is why you're calling it as a constant. Right? So this is minus 20. And so on. Okay. Value of m is in decibels. For the second term, we employ the asymptotic analysis and we realize that, okay, if I am at 0.01, 20 log of 0.01 is minus 40 decibels. Right? So this is minus 40. And I immediately see that if I have a zero at the origin, I'm going to have a positive slope. Right? I'm going to be increasing by an amount of 20 decibels as I drop by every negative. Okay? In some sense, you're growing smaller as you grow older, but that will happen in real life. Minus 20. Log of 1 is 0, less than. Plus 20. Plus 40. Plus 60. And likewise, you can do the same thing for the remaining term as well. So that's minus 10 log of 1 plus omega by 10 whole square. Here is where you do the asymptotic analysis. You say that if omega is much lesser than 10, which means if omega is 0.01 or 0.1 or 1, there is no contribution whatsoever from that particular term. Okay? So all these will be 0 for this particular term. That is the asymptotic analysis that we have performed. There is not much of an asymptotic analysis for this guy. Okay, so this is going to be 0, approximately. It will keep on doing this until you hit the corner frequency of 10. And starting from the corner frequency, it will keep increasing by an amount of, decreasing by an amount of 20 decibels, right? Because if my omega is very large, then this becomes minus 10 log of omega squared, essentially, which is minus 20 log of omega. So I'm increasing negatively by 20 decibels. Am I making sense to everyone? These are all approximate here too. Okay, this is still an asymptotic analysis. And all you do is add these features up, draw the plot and go. Okay, so I just want to make a note here. Have a zero, increasing slope. If you have a cone, decreasing slope, look at the asymptotic analysis and call it a day. Total magnitude. If I add all of these up, until the break frequency of 10 radians per second, I am sitting at a slope of 20 decibels per decade, but it is just offset by a certain amount. So this is minus 60. Minus 20, until I hit the break frequency, 0, 16 minus 40 is 0. And the magnitude plot can be drawn in the following manner. I'm going to draw it in a separate. This is to kind of make amends on what I did last time, which was a little more hasty. This is making sense to me. Yes, sir. So starting from 0.01, omega 0.01 sitting here. This is radians per second on the log scale. Okay, then on the y-axis I'm going to have magnitude m. In decibels, I'm going to start at minus 60, increasing slope of 20 decibels per decade until I hit the break frequency of 10 radians per second, as you can see. 20 decibels per decade, increasing slope. So the intermediate values. Explain. Are you all sure this is a low pass filter? Remember, if your gain is 0 decibels on the Godey plot, this implies that the output and input are equal to each other. That the gain here is such that the output is the same as the input, so the gain here is that the output is lesser than the input, so this is actually a high pass and not a low pass. Okay, so this is the pass band. This is the cut. Frequency response function, which is somewhere here, and then look at the phase of that. So angle P of j omega. Okay, what's that going to be? 1 by 10, not much of a contributor, but I can plug it together with this omega. Okay. So on the numerator, I have the following. It's tan inverse you've seen this before. If I have things multiplying or dividing, then they become either subtractions or additions. Even for the face, this is going to be tan inverse of the following. So it is that. And that's going to be 0.1 omega. Divided by one. Power omega by 10. Break frequency at some point, then radians per second. Okay, so omega CD. And it is very easy to see that if my omega is very small, it means if my omega is less than 10 radians per second, then tan inverse of a very small quantity is zero. So I'm essentially asymptotically going to say that if I start with 0, this quantity is 0 to begin with. This is 0. So this is essentially minus tan inverse of omega by 10. So for small omega, tan inverse of that quantity is close to 0, asymptotically and approximately. I hit the break frequency, things start picking up some juice. And then I immediately see that as the value of omega keeps increasing, as omega keeps growing infinitely large, tan inverse of an infinitely large quantity becomes equal to pi by 2. So for large values of omega, I'm sitting at pi by 2, but with a negative sign, because I have a negative sign here. Okay, so. And my phase plot asymptotic approximation. Going to be that quantity. The real plot might look something like this. Okay, and likewise the real plot of the body will magnitude will look something like this. And as you can see, the face is not very interesting. And all it says is that okay, until I hit the counter frequency, the input and the output signals are in phase with each other. As soon as I go past the corner frequency, they go out of phase with each other if I plot them as waveforms. Our interest is mostly in the magnitude plot. All right, so this is the end of the first order system. I want to move on to interesting stuff. I will make sure that in recitation, your DA goes through more first order examples with more poles and so on, or zeros which are not necessarily at the origin. But if you know how to do this, you're good to go for first order. It cannot be anything worse than this. Second order systems. They are the more crazier of the two. LC circuit. Okay, because we're doing electrical systems as well, right? So this is an RLC circuit, which means that I have a resistor. It's a series RLC circuit, I'm sorry. I have a resistor, an inductor, and a capacitor combined with each other, connected to an ideal voltage source, sinusoidal voltage source. Direction of current flow is clockwise. And let's say here are the impedances of the resistor, the inductor, and the capacitor. So this is LS, R, 1S. Blocks in series, same current flowing through, which means the effective impedance is just for the sum of all of these three put together. Okay, so if I write the input output relationship in this case, looking at the current. Ts multiplied by R is C times R times S. 1 multiplied by 1 is 4 to the power. More of this divided by the common denominator of C. The big X. K is equal to 1, so you can substitute that. If I now find the transfer function for the system, I end up with a power vector. K is equal to 1, okay, just for simplicity. As a matter of comparison, I'm going to look at the transfer function of this creature, which is the output voltage by the input voltage in the Laplace domain. So common comparison tells you that 1 by LC is the same as the natural frequency omega n squared. Right? So omega n is square root of 1 by LC. Just by comparison, apples to apples here. Omega n. Radians per second. Okay. Then I can also obtain zeta based upon the combination of the resistor and the capacitor elements. It makes sense that zeta is dependent on the resistor because the resistor is a dissipative element in the circuit. Okay, so if I look at it, I end up getting 2 zeta by omega n is R times C. If I substitute for omega n, I get zeta minus R root of C by L. I'm going to take this one. examine the parameters of the electrical system. Here is what I want to do. I want to find the magnitude of the frequency response function. So first let's write the frequency response function from now on. I'm not going to write it in terms of L, C, and R. I'm going to write it in terms of omega n and theta, just two parameters. Okay? Wherever we see an omega n, it is understood that that guy is 1 by L, C squared. Okay? So just zeta and omega n, generic second order system. We have j omega from that particular term there. That will be 1 by. Watch this. S square, if I substitute S is equal to j omega, becomes a minus omega square. Okay? I have a 1 which is untouched, so this is 1 minus omega square, omega n square multiplied by j. I'm sorry, no j. Plus j times 2 zeta by omega n. So that's going to be with an s there, so that's 2 zeta omega by omega n. And now we're going to define a new term called as the frequency ratio, which is the excitation frequency divided by the natural frequency. And I want to call it a little r. So r has a lot of meaning for us, as you're going to see in the next 10 minutes. Yeah, 7 minutes. I'm going to find the magnitude of the frequency response function. So, magnitude is going to be the following. So, this is 1 by square root 1 in the numerator because there is nothing in terms of the imaginary component there. In the denominator, square root of the sum of the real and the imaginary parts. 1 by big brackets start. Real part is 1 minus r square, square of that guy. 1 minus r square, whole square. Square of 2 zeta. Go to the power 1. Now something nice to look at here, right, is if I have no damping, this is gone, I'm just left with 1 minus r square, my frequency response function is purely a real number given without taking any of the magnitudes. If zeta is equal to 0, this is just 1 by 1 minus r square. And when r is equal to 1, when the excitation frequency is equal to the natural frequency, in the absence of any damping, what happens to the magnitude? Grows up to infinity. And this is complete garbage because we are looking at a linear system. So the excitation is non-linear now. The spring is getting stretched to an infinitely large extent. So all the stuff that you've done breaks down. We cannot use our linear approximations in the situation of a resonant field. Yes?
Is that second term supposed to be squared too?
Oh, yes. Thank you. That will be done for the next time. But you know, we'll look at the situation of zeta being 0 separately. You know, we touch it with some amount of respect. And keep in mind the limitations of linear. reducing its complexity. And by saying that, okay, hey, even though I have a nonlinear system, there are pockets of behavior that are linear. And if I look at these pockets of behavior and I stitch together the entire behavior, I get a qualitative description of the entire nonlinear system. That is the powerfulness of linear system analysis. Yeah? Okay. I want to now do a little bit of differentiation. I want to find out what is the value of the frequency at which the magnitude becomes a maximum, which is nothing but saying, okay, take the derivative of this ugly looking thing with respect to r, set it equal to 0. I'm going to skip a lot of steps. Okay, so my aim, too early for the next class.
So sorry, I don't have to this morning.
Thank you, it's too late to. I've already blown the ones apart. To find P of j omega magnitude, right? This is a function of the circular frequency omega. So I said P by B omega. But really, natural frequency is fixed, so I can as well differentiate with respect to the frequency ratio. I don't need to differentiate with respect to omega, so I can say that this is d by dr. This is equal to 0. Okay? I'm going to do this quickly. I'm going to take this panel off. In the denominator, the numerator is what I'm interested in. So 1 minus r square minus 2 minus 2r, differentiation of the quantity 1 minus r square whole square with respect to r, plus differentiation of the quantity 2 zeta r whole square with respect to r is 4 zeta square times r times 2. All of that will be equal to 0. Numerator divided by denominator is equal to 0, so obviously the numerator is 0. So I'm going to set the quantity in the numerator to be equal to 0. So I end up getting 2, 1 minus r squared minus 2r plus 4 zeta squared, 2r is equal to 0. Start cancelling of terms, 2r, 2r. Negative sign, so bring quantities onto the right hand side and left hand side. So I have 2 times 1 minus r squared is 4 zeta squared. Times 2 is mostly 4. So I can write the form. Okay, 1 minus r square is zeta square, 2 zeta square, or r square is 1 minus 2 zeta square, or r is plus or minus 1 minus 2 zeta square. R is what, omega by omega n. Take the positive root, but in practice one can take the negative root as well. And I'm going to call this frequency omega at that particular value as a special frequency omega suffix r. Where omega suffix r denotes the resonance frequency of the system, or the frequency of the system at resonance. largest magnitude, and so the resonant frequency. Omega r cross multiply is omega n times. Minus 2 zeta square, not to be confused with this cousin brother, which is omega d, which is omega n times square root of 1 minus zeta square. Different. They're two different creatures. Two different things, very different things. We are more interested in omega d in time domain systems. In frequency response, we are more interested.